My name's Liam Southall. I'm a documentary filmmaker. I was born and raised in the historic city of Bath. Growing up here, it felt that the place had something special about it. An inspiration from the hills, buildings, and the people. It's something I haven't felt since. And now, after 3 years, I'm going back. I want to find out if there is something really special about this city. Or if there's some sort of strange regional patriotism. And does this small pocket of the West Country have some sort of unusual effect on its residents of 80,000 people? Residents such as Nicolas Cage, Ken Loach, Peter Gabriel, and once, Jane Austen. I'm going to meet two of the city's most prolific artists and find out, if at all, how the city of Bath has influenced their work. How much are we the product of the environment we live in? My search for answers begins with one of the most sought-after painters from the city, Pete Brown. His dedication to painting Bath in all weather has made Pete a recognisable sight in the city. And earned him the nickname, Pete the Street. In 2006, he became the first artist in residence at the Savoy Hotel, London. And, in 2008, won the Prince of Wales Award for Portrait Painting. I joined Pete soon after the opening of his latest exhibition, Bath Between the Snows, to learn more about his relationship with the city.
I first came in 86, to do my foundation course, and I found the city quite exciting because it suddenly, from coming from a market town, and suddenly there was this space and amazing, you know, architecture and stuff, and it was quite an amazing thing. Oh, I don't know, 10 years later, something like that, or whenever it was, 8 years later, that we returned to Bath, Lisa and I, because we were doing nothing, we were temping, we came back to Bath because we knew it was a beautiful place, we had friends here. And I don't know what it was, but that's what got me drawing again. I'd given up art altogether and drawing, really, for about a year. I hadn't really done anything after art college in Manchester and stuff. But there was something about Bath that got me. Well, it's particularly draw as well in charcoal, tonal drawings, and they were bloody awful. But the important thing was, it got me going again and sort of painting really with my heart. Really, I found the buildings then very kind of grand and you know, a real city that was alive really as well.
That's right, yeah.
Oh, because I want to go and see your exhibition.
Oh, check out the show. Oh, right, okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, I shan't hold you to it if you don't.
Bath is a very small place, and so I've seen how we've all got a bit older. You know, seeing people kind of becoming infirm and stuff like that is quite revealing, really. And you think you're just looking at them getting older, and then you realise that kind of we're all getting older, you know. What I think is unique about Bath is that it's almost out of place. It's not the Cotswolds, it's not London, it's kind of it's a kind of rural city. It's a town, really, a rural town. And that's quite interesting. It's very much like a very busy market town, really, as opposed to a kind of city. What you don't get, and I keep coming back to it, and it's, you know, everyone says it, is you don't get, the stone doesn't react like it does in Bath. You know, it's quite, I think that is quite, that is the thing, that's the key, that's the, I mean, the Georgian architecture is beautiful and it's got lovely proportions, you know, chimney stacks and things like that are all lush and lovely to paint sort of thing, but I think it's the light hitting the facade of the buildings, which is kind of lush.
I'm meeting another of the city's artists. John Eaves. Recognised for his abstract pieces, John has lived and worked in Bath since the 1950s. All from the same house, overlooking the city of Bath. In the 90s, IKEA picked up John's painting, Blue Spreading, selling 45,000 copies. It became a bestseller. He's also a family friend. As a young boy, John's paintings hung throughout my house and got me first thinking about art. I was fascinated in how John's work had come about and how it was based in landscapes. I spent hours looking at them, trying to find a meaning. I wanted to find out, could Bath be found in John's abstract work?
I think it was the second painting, the big one, was perhaps, you know, it's in line with everything I do. It's a kind of improvisation on this. Mm-hmm. It's not strictly true, but nevertheless, without seeing the snow, without seeing this scene, I wouldn't have done the painting. Not that far. I think the sort of clarity you're getting with those group of trees is what I would really be aiming for in there, that kind of clarity of slightly varying things. Yeah. But you can see little groups of trees there that are sort of blobby in the sense of that is. Mm. I quite like that idea that you don't see a leaf as a leaf, but you just see it as a mass. That's more interesting. Yeah.
I asked John how it had come about that he started painting the colourful work that he was known for. He led us to the back of his house to explain.
Basically, what happened is they played in the street here. Not this particular wall, but any of the walls would have done. And they all had chalks. And they would go to one of the stones, and I think in this case, you know, one like this. And they would literally, day after day, chalk it. So that at the moment it's still grainy. But if you imagine more and more children drawing this, while they were playing hopscotch or something in the street as well, this one stone got completely whitened. Then that became an image I could realise I could use this plus this ochre shapes and these divisions in a painting. But, and so I suppose you could say that that was the first time I'd really sort of broken away from landscape with perspective and all that kind of thing in trees, and I realised that landscape could be something much more of the earth. Not on the earth, but of it. And chalk is still that substance too. So and then I took other images, you know, black stones, red stones, which you could see in Bath in those times. They were part of walls, part of things. But they hadn't been cleaned up. We have to get used to the fact that Bath is a clean city now. All the walls are cleaned up, everything's washed down, and any semblance of a black area or a red area or something is taken out. You will see that it's not actually that dissimilar. I wanted a landscape which was a kind of urban landscape, not the landscape of trees necessarily, but the landscape of the way we constructed it in walls and houses. But I didn't want to draw a house as such. I didn't want to draw trees. I had done that. I was wanting to develop it more in a kind of non-figurative dare I say, abstract way, but I didn't know that at the time quite, but this led me to it. That was really it, this. It was the first time I'd sort of managed to do something minus perspective. New images. They're not direct images from landscape. They're, you know, you're arriving at a different structure. You want to invent right from the beginning. But you have to draw, you obviously will draw on things that you've learned or that you've seen in the past. They will get employed. Oh, it's just it's an amazing sight. I mean, I'm continually amazed about that. Even though you may not directly paint it anymore, it's still influential.
My time in Bath had finally come to an end, and it had been an amazing experience. Although in different ways, it was clear that the city still inspired Pete and John. So was there something special about this city? You'll have to see for yourselves.